Well, hello, church. Pastor Michael here. Glad that you could join us tonight for Good Friday. If you haven't already, grab your Bibles, your pen, your paper, because we're going to dig into God's Word together tonight. If you have your worship guide in front of you, hopefully you've just finished reading our passage for tonight, Luke chapter 23, verses 26 to 56. If you haven't, though, why don't you go ahead and push pause and take time to read the passage. If you want a copy of the worship guide, you can find it in the comments below, or if you go to gfc1.org. Well, it's my prayer and hope that tonight you'll be encouraged in your faith. We are going to look at a familiar story for most of us, and so I'm praying that Jesus would give us a fresh encounter with him tonight. Would you pray with me as we go to God's Word now? Dear Jesus, we just ask and pray that you would give us ears to hear and eyes to see, that we might savor you afresh tonight. Would you encourage our faith as we reflect on who you are and what you did when you died for us on the cross? In Jesus' name, amen. Well, there have been so many famous deaths in history, including many heroic deaths in order to save lives, but none of them has been as far-reaching as the death of Jesus Christ. Jesus gave his life so that we might live, so that we might have forgiveness and peace with God and eternal life through faith in him. The Bible says that Jesus was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities, that the punishment that brought us peace was on him, and that by his wounds we are healed. Isaiah 53, verse 5. Our fundamental problem as human beings is sin. It's not education or finances or food. Our fundamental problem is sin. We do things that God says not to, and we fail to do the things that God tells us to do. That's sin. We're all guilty of it. We covet, we lie, we lust, we steal, we get angry with people. But more than that, we fail to honor God. We fail to love God with everything we are and to love other people, as God tells us in his word. And that sin makes us deserving of God's judgment for that sin. And that's exactly why Jesus came. He came, he bore our sins, he took the punishment that we deserve in our place, dying in our place so that we might have forgiveness and eternal life through him. And that's what we celebrate on Good Friday. Well, in response to that, we praise or put our faith in Jesus Christ, and we live our faith in Jesus Christ. That is the two lenses that we want to look at our text through tonight. In our passage, we're going to see three encounters with Jesus. And each one of those encounters is going to give us a glimpse of Jesus Christ, and it's going to encourage our faith in him. So let's look at the first encounter. We pick up the history with Jesus being led out to the cross to be crucified. And here, in this first encounter, we see women encounter Jesus, the prophet. We see this in verses 26 to 31. Look at verse 26. As they led him away, they seized one Simon of Cyrene, and they made him carry Jesus' cross and follow along behind him. Now, there's this great crowd of people, and they're all following along. They want to see the spectacle of crucifixion. And among them, there are these women who are weeping for what is happening to Jesus. And Jesus turns to them, and he says, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves." Now, why does he say that? He says that because he knows that judgment is coming on Jerusalem. And we've already seen this twice in Luke. So this is the third time that Jesus predicts the fall of Jerusalem, and it was fulfilled in AD 70. And the reason this judgment is coming on them is because they rejected Jesus. We saw that in Luke chapter 19, especially in verse 44. They failed to recognize the time of their visitation. And that judgment on Jerusalem, though, it just foreshadows the final ultimate judgment that people will face in hell if they reject Jesus. You see, there is no good news of salvation until we first come to grips with the bad news. And that is that if we reject Jesus Christ, then we will suffer the terror and torment of God's judgment for our sins. So weep for yourselves, Jesus says. Weep for your sin and let it lead you to faith in Jesus Christ. And even as Christians, there is a place for us to weep for our sin, to weep for the ways in which we have failed to live out our faith in Jesus. So first, we see some women encounter Jesus the prophet. Second, we see the mockers encounter Jesus the priest. We see this in verses 32 to 38. Jesus wasn't crucified alone. Look at verse 32. Two others who were criminals were also led away with him to be put to death. And when they came to the place that is called the skull, there they crucified him. Now the gospel writers don't describe crucifixion because the original audience, their audience would have been familiar and understood the horrors of crucifixion. After flogging Jesus, after whipping him with a whip embedded with bits of metal and bone, tearing his back to shreds, they force him to carry his cross, which he can't do because he's too weak. So they make Simon of Cyrene carry it for him. When they get to the hill where they're going to crucify him, they take a metal spike, a nail like this one, and they hammer it into his feet and into his wrists, and they hang him up on the cross to die. Now, in order to breathe, Jesus would have to push down on the nail in his feet and pull on the nails in his wrists in order to lift himself up to get a breath. And every time, his back scraping against the wood, his wounds bleeding, his body in agony every moment. And it's while Jesus is hanging on the cross that the soldiers cast lots to divide up his garments. We see that in verse 34. And then everyone mocks Jesus. The religious leaders mock Jesus, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself. If he's the Christ of God, his chosen one." They relish this opportunity to humiliate the one who dared to expose their own hypocrisy. The soldiers join in the mocking and they say, "If you're the king of the Jews, save yourself." And Matthew tells us that the crowds also mock him, saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross." Matthew 27:40. And Matthew also tells us that both of the thieves mock him in the exact same way. That's verse 44. So everyone is asking Jesus to get off the cross and prove that he's the Savior. Of course, the irony is that if he does come down and save himself, then he wouldn't have saved anyone else. And it was common for criminals, for men to, when they were being crucified, to scream at, to curse at the crowds, or to plead with them. Is that what Jesus does here? No, he doesn't do that. What does he do? He prays. And is he praying for himself? No, he prays for his enemies. He's praying for them. Look at verse 34. Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." This is an amazing glimpse of Jesus Christ. In the midst of all their ridicule, in the midst of all the pain that is racking his body, Jesus prays for his enemies. He prays for their forgiveness. 7 times Jesus spoke from the cross, and this very first word, he prays for the forgiveness of those who crucified him. He prays they would have an opportunity to hear the gospel and turn to him and be forgiven. That should blow us away. That should make us go, whoa. Jesus prays for the soldiers who tortured him. He prays for Pilate, who condemned him to save his own skin. He prays for the religious leaders who conspired to destroy him. And he prays for the mob who helped them, for they're guilty as well. They're implicated too. Acts chapter 2, 36 and Acts 3, 17. But let's not forget that we all have a part in putting Jesus on that cross. It was the sins of the world that nailed him there, your sin and mine. So we are implicated here as well. Jesus intercedes for them and for us as our great high priest, praying that we would find forgiveness. And it didn't take long for this prayer to begin to be answered. The thief, as we'll see, puts his faith in Jesus. The centurion declares the deity of Christ. On the day of Pentecost, 3,000 people are going to become Christians. And not long after that, many of the priests themselves become obedient to the faith. Acts chapter 6, verse 7. And even Paul. Many of these people who had a hand in crucifying Jesus, they are all turning to Jesus and they find forgiveness and they're saved. Do you see Jesus here? Can you see and savor Jesus? Be awed by him. Jesus prayed from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." It's absolutely an amazing prayer. These compelling words are proof of Christ's love and compassion for sinners, and they convict us to love our enemies, to follow his example, and do as he did, and just as he taught us in Luke chapter 6. Now, if the very men who murdered Jesus can be forgiven, then there is no one who is beyond the reach of God's mercy. And this prayer gives hope to every sinner who would put their faith in Jesus Christ to be saved. Jesus loves you, and he wants you to come to him. Turn from your sin to Jesus Christ. Put your faith in him to save you. But if you're a believer and you've already done that, then live your faith in Jesus. Follow his example, as we're told in 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 to 24. Jesus taught us to love our enemies, and here he shows us that and gives us an example of loving our enemies. And so we pray for those who persecute us, and we return good for evil, and we bless those who curse. And moreover, we extend the forgiveness that we have received to other people. Well, what right do we have to withhold forgiveness from other people, seeing that we have been forgiven so much? These are the lessons for us as believers here. While we've seen the women encounter Jesus, the prophet, the mockers encounter Jesus, the priest, and finally the thief encounters Jesus, the king. We see this in verses 39 to 43. We saw already that both of these criminals, these robbers, were mocking Jesus and reviling him. That's Matthew 27, 44. But at some point, one of them has a change of heart, and he then turns and rebukes his fellow criminal, and he appeals to Jesus. Look at verse 40. He says, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we," he says to his fellow criminal, "we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward for our deeds." And then he said to Jesus, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Now, what happened to change his heart? I think he sees Jesus' response to his enemies, how he shows love and compassion by praying for their forgiveness, for God to show them mercy. And God opens his heart to believe. And it's an incredible faith. We see his faith both in his rebuke of the other thief, and also in his appeal to Jesus. Let's look at both of those. First, in his rebuke. We see this sudden reverence. He says, "Do you not fear God?" It's absolutely incredible that he can see that God is with Jesus, despite the fact that he's being crucified and the religious leaders have condemned him. Then there is this repentance. He says, essentially, we're getting what we deserve. We're being condemned for what we have done, and that's just. So he acknowledges his sin and the justice of the punishment for his sins. And third, there is this recognition that Jesus is innocent. He says he has done nothing wrong. He's righteous. He doesn't deserve this. This criminal can see that Jesus is hanging on that cross because of other men's crimes, not his own. Jesus is being punished for the sins of others. That's the gospel. Well, we also see his faith in his appeal to Jesus. He says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." This is amazing. Not only does he recognize that Jesus is innocent, he knows three other things about Jesus as well. First, he knows that Jesus is a king. Second, he knows that Jesus' kingdom is not of this world. I mean, think about this. Jesus is dying on the cross, and yet he knows this is not the end for Jesus, that Jesus will come into his kingdom beyond the grave. And third, he knows that this king, has the power to save even the most unworthy of sinners? Or why would he plead with him to remember him? And this is absolutely incredible. Look at this. The thief believes that Jesus is a king who is going to come into his kingdom. In other words, he believes that Jesus' crucifixion will not be the end for him. He will be victorious over death. And the thief believes that Jesus is able to do something for him, that he is able to bring him into his kingdom. And so he pleads with Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." Now, he believes all of this despite the fact that Jesus is being crucified and condemned as a fraud by all of the religious leaders. He believes all of this despite the fact that all the circumstances point in a different direction. His faith is absolutely tremendous. Now, in response to his faith, Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." The first word that Jesus spoke from the cross was a prayer of intercession as our high priest. The second word that Jesus speaks is a declaration as king, promising welcome into his kingdom. And this gives such assurance to those who believe. Don't miss this. Let's look at this. Look at the certainty here. Jesus says, "Truly, truly I say to you." Second, look at the timing. Jesus says, today you will be with me. The moment you die, you will be in paradise with Jesus. Look at the relationship. Jesus says, you'll be with me, in whose presence there is fullness of joy. And then finally, look at the glory. Jesus says, today you'll be with me in paradise, free from all pain, full of all joy. You have nothing to fear from death, is what he is saying to the thief on the cross and what he is saying to us. It's an amazing assurance to those who put their faith in Jesus Christ. In that very moment, the thief has all of his sins canceled. They're paid in full, nailed to the cross in Jesus Christ. And he's promised that there's this kingdom that awaits him. Do you see your Savior King here? Even during the mocking of the crowds and the pain of the cross, he is still doing his Father's work, for he came to seek and to save the lost. He is just a few hours from death, struggling for every breath, racked with searing pain, and Jesus, even in the midst of this, brings a common criminal into the glorious kingdom of God. He speaks such assurance, not just for the thief on the cross, but for all who put their faith in him to save them. Jesus is so worthy of our admiration and our worship. We are forgiven and saved, and we enter into the kingdom by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. The thief doesn't have time to do any good works. We're not saved by our good deeds. We're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. And the thief is an illustration of that. Despite the fact that the thief has tremendous faith, his faith is incredible, his conversion is not ideal. Deathbed conversions are not ideal because we don't know if we're going to die before we have a chance to repent and believe in Jesus. So don't wait. Put your faith in Jesus today. But it's also not ideal because his life was wasted in sin, when it could have been lived in service to the king, for the glory of God and for the good of others. Nevertheless, if the thief on the cross can be saved, then so can you. So put your faith in Jesus for your salvation. If you're already in Christ, then rest in your assurance of salvation and your place in the kingdom of God. You have nothing to fear from death. That truth gives us strength to endure in the midst of tribulation. It gives us joy in the face of persecution, and it gives us comfort in the hour of our death. So live for the King. And Jesus was on the cross for roughly 6 hours. Verse 44 tells us that there was darkness over the whole land from the sixth hour, that's about midday, to the ninth hour, that's the mid-afternoon. So from about noon to 3 o'clock, those 3 hours, there was darkness over the whole land. Now that isn't an eclipse, which only lasts for a few minutes. This is a supernatural darkness lasting 3 hours during the brightest part of the day. And it's a sign of God's judgment and God's grief in the death of his son. Well, the centurion sees all of these things that had happened. Jesus, in his last moment, says, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. And the centurion, he sees Jesus died and all the things that have taken place, and he says, "Certainly this man is innocent." And all the crowds that have assembled for the spectacle, they see everything, and they go home beating their breasts. They're grieved by what has taken place. And Jesus' acquaintance, all of his friends, those who know him, they stood at a distance watching these things, stunned and confused. That's three responses, and it leads me to ask a question. How will you respond to Jesus? Let me suggest three ways that you might respond tonight. First, weep for your sin and come to Jesus for forgiveness. Maybe tonight you're burdened with the weight of your sin and guilt. Weep for it like Jesus told the women. Let it lead you to repent and believe in Jesus. Maybe for the first time tonight you're seeing Jesus like the thief saw Jesus for the first time on the cross. Appeal to Jesus like he did, saying something like this: "Jesus, I know that I've sinned. I acknowledge my sin. I confess it to you, and I deserve punishment for that. That's just. Thank you for dying in my place for my sins. I'm putting my faith and my trust in you to save me. Would you bring me into your kingdom? I want to live for you, my King." Or maybe as a Christian, you need to weep over your sin and confess it to Jesus tonight. Let this be a time for you to renew your relationship with Jesus. Maybe you've been toying around with sin in your life when you should be weeping over it. Take it to the cross. Confess that sin tonight and be forgiven. That sin was nailed to the cross. Live then your faith in Jesus. Well, second, worship your Savior tonight. I hope you can see and savor Jesus. See Jesus praying with compassion for wretched sinners like us. See Jesus willingly stay on the cross in order to sacrifice himself to save us. See Jesus giving us such assurance for those who have faith in him that we have a place in his kingdom. And that as you see Jesus, it would strengthen your faith and it would lead you to savor him in joyful worship. A third and finally, I would hope that you're encouraged to serve Jesus, your matchless King. There is none greater than him. Even though Jesus died with nothing, not even the clothes on his back taken from him by the soldiers, even though he was crucified as a criminal with other criminals, even though he left no descendants, no property, and no money, hardly what we would call a successful life by worldly standards. Yet Jesus, in his life, ministry, teaching, his death and resurrection on the cross, has literally changed the world. He has left millions of spiritual descendants. He leaves an inheritance that will never perish, spoil, or fade. And his legacy is eternal. See him and savor him and